They resound with God's own heart. Oh, let the ancient words impart words of life, words of hope. Give us strength, help us cope in this world wherever we roam.
To you, welcome to morning meditation for today. Today is what, Tuesday? Yes, today is Tuesday, the 10th of November, and what a wonderful and blessed day it is. And even though it is raining outside, I declare that today is another blessed, wonderful opportunity that God has given us. Today, another opportunity for us to experience His goodness, another opportunity for us to experience grace and mercy and faithfulness and goodness and all the things, the wonderful things that God has in store for us. Today is a day of blessings. I declare Today is a day of victory. Today is a day where we get to know God, where we get to experience God, hallelujah, at another level. Today is a day where we give thanks and we are grateful for who God is, for what He has done, for what He has given us. Today is a day we recognize and we acknowledge that God is our strength, God is our rock, God is our refuge, our very present help in trouble. Every day we're supposed to acknowledge that it is God who has enabled us to be alive in this day. So I greet you in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, our soon coming King, the name of the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the name of the one at whose name every knee must bow, every tongue confess, and that is Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. And people will recognize that He is Lord to the glory of God the Father. This morning, I trust that you are waking up with that kind of excitement and kind of expectancy, hallelujah, as to what God is going to do in our lives and through us today, hallelujah. There's mixed feelings inside of me this morning, because you know you're looking at the news and seeing all the coverage of the floods that has happened in the Caribbean. Oh, and it is sad. So many people have lost their homes. So many people are displaced by this tropical storm that passed over us and became a hurricane, and that is Eta. And we need to continue to pray for these people who have been displaced in one way or another, losing their homes, losing their valuables. Some lives have been lost because of this natural disaster. And you know, it goes back to what we have been saying, even during this pandemic. You know, we have to be people who are, you know, mindful that you know, things happen that are beyond our control, and things will happen that are beyond our control. But there are certain things that are within our control, and we need to take heed, you know, to warnings. We need to take heed to instructions. We need to take heed. You know, it doesn't mean that things will not happen still, but when you take heed and you follow instructions and you know, you put yourself in a better place to survive. You put yourself in a better place to make it through, whether it be a hurricane, whether it be, you know, tropical storm, you know, the pandemic. You know, simple instructions can save lives. You know, like clearing your drains, you know, getting rid of debris in your yard, you know, that will clog drains and stuff like that. Because water is one of those natural elements that has no regard for anybody. It has no preference, it has no favoritism, and it will create havoc where it has to, and that's just the nature of water. So, you know, when especially being in the hurricane season, you know, when we notice that this is what it is, we take steps to avoid us being, you know, affected in serious ways, and sometimes fatal ways. Okay, so this morning we have to be people of obedience, and that's what Peter says. Peter says, listen, submit to authorities, submit to those people, you know, who give instructions, submit to them, you know, because they are there for our protection. That's what the Bible says. They're there for our protection. So this morning we continue to pray for families, we continue to pray for you know, these people who don't even know where they're going to spend the night tonight. And we pray that God will provide some food, shelter for them, you know, in the name of Jesus. And we continue to pray for us here down here in St. Lucia, that God would continue to make a way for us, continue to give us wisdom, give us understanding, strategies, that we'll be able to navigate through this very, very, very difficult time of our lives. Amen. And this morning, we just want to greet our seniors, honored seniors, in the mighty name of Jesus. We pray that God will continue to bless you, continue to carry you, cover you in Jesus' name, continue to hold you up, strengthen you in Jesus' mighty and precious name. As we go into our song this morning, we want to magnify God. We want to glorify His name. You know, we want to just take some time, you know, and acknowledge who God is and thank Him for His goodness and His grace, hallelujah, over our lives in Jesus' name. So we go into a song right now, Be Magnified, and we'll come back and go into the Word of God this morning. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
That you were unable to
magnified, O Lord. And that is what we are doing this morning, on morning meditation. We are magnifying the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and lifting him up this morning on this beautiful Tuesday morning. And we pray that God will continue to be magnified through us, even in this day, as we go through this day, that God's life would be lived in us and it would radiate from us into the environment around us, into the space around us, in the mighty name of Jesus. May we be people who can walk into an environment and set the atmosphere right with the presence of God today, in the mighty name of Jesus. Oh, to God be the glory. Well, this morning we are going into the Word of God, and we'll be looking at John chapter 8, John chapter 8, verse 31 to 36. John chapter 8, verse 31 to 36. And we will be looking at the title this morning, The Truth Shall Make You Free. The Truth Shall Make You Free. I've spoken on this passage already on one angle, but this morning I want to go into another aspect of this passage in John chapter 8. The truth shall make you free. I declare this morning that we are truly people of freedom, that we are walking in the freedom that God has given us. And Paul said in Galatians, it is for freedom that Christ has made us free. Only do not use this freedom, this liberty, as license to sin, license for the flesh. Hallelujah. We have been made free. We have been made, hallelujah, we have been set free, hallelujah, by the Lord Jesus Christ. So this morning we are here as free people. Once we were bound in sin and the flesh, once we were captivated by the flesh, once we were imprisoned by the flesh, but this morning, hallelujah, we stand as people who have been set free, no longer walking according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. And maybe somebody might be saying, oh boy, I really tried. It's a struggle sometimes to maintain my walk. It's a trouble. It's a struggle sometimes to maintain my faith. It's a struggle. Sometimes I doubt. Oh God, that's the truth. Some people say sometimes I doubt. You know, sometimes I miss. And that's part of life. That's part of the journey. Our journey to perfection. We are not there yet, but that's the journey to perfection. And as I speak, you know, even this morning, I am not speaking to people who have arrived. I am not speaking to people who have made it. I'm not speaking to people, you know, who have eradicated sin completely from their lives, and they are no longer prone to sin, no longer tempted. No, if I'm talking to real people this morning, I'm talking to people who know what the struggle is. You know what the journey is all about. But the truth is, we have been made free by the Lord Jesus Christ. We are people who are free. Oh, glory be to God. Glory be to God. So we are free to trust God. We are free to believe in God. We are free to come to God and say, God, this is who I am. This is where I am. This is who I am. God, I need your strength. I need your love. I need your grace. I need mercy, God. And the Bible says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Oh, bless the name of Jesus. Bless the name of Jesus. Oh, glory to God. Glory to God. So in John chapter 8, verse 31, we get the account of Jesus in conversation with the Jews. And if you read from verse 1, it's a back and forth. Jesus is trying to tell them who he is, and they're trying to counteract that, and it's a back and forth. Jesus is telling them, listen, I've spoken to you and you don't believe me, and they are, Abraham is our father. It's a back and forth and back and forth. So in verse 31, Jesus says this: then Jesus said to the Jews, to those Jews who believed on him, or who believed him. There were people who were actually, there were Jews who were actually listening to Jesus in the midst of the back and forth and the maybe arguments that were going on with some of the Jews. There were people who were listening to Jesus and maybe saying in their mind, you know, in their heart, you know what this guy is saying is, there may be some truth to it. There may be some, you know, merit to what he's saying. And the Bible says, those Jews who believed him, he says to them, if you abide in my word, you are my disciples. If you abide in my word, you are my disciples. Indeed. And listen to what he says. And you shall know the truth. And the truth shall make you free. In other words, you shall be able to distinguish between what is false and what is true. And that truth that you find will make you free. Yes, there's a choice to be made, Lucy. And there's a lot of falsehood out there. There's a lot of falsehood out there. Like you know, on the news these days, fake news, a lot of fake news out there, saying that Jesus is a character made up by the Europeans to keep black people in slavery. A lot of news out there that God is everywhere. God is in the trees. God is in the ground. God is in the sun. God is in the rock. There's a lot of false out there. People who are news and falsehood that will tell you, you know, you will never be able to overcome. You will never be able to overcome your fears, or overcome your flesh, or overcome or walk victoriously. We are human beings, and psychologically, people will tell you, you know, it is innate, it is in us for us to behave certain ways, and that's how we were born and will continue. Or there are people who will tell you, you know, that's how your father was, that's how your mother was, and because of that, you have inherited that kind of behavior. You haven't, and the chances are you will become like your father, or you will become like your mother. And Jesus says, you shall know the truth, and the truth will make you free. We have to be able to distinguish the truth from the falsehood. But how does that happen? How can that happen? Jesus says, if you abide in my word. If you abide in my word. In other words, as my word continue to fill your life, as you continue to avail yourself to my word has the ability to give you that kind of discernment you need to know what is truth. And upon accepting that truth, you will receive freedom. Oh, glory to God. Glory to God. Freedom. It says, you are my disciples indeed. If my words abide in you, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Now, the question we have to ask here is really, but what is truth? What is truth? And that is the question Pilate asked Jesus in the book of John, chapter 18. The Bible says, Pilate was questioning Jesus. Jesus is on trial, and Pilate has Jesus inside, and the crowd is outside, and Pilate is asking Jesus, saying to Jesus, "You are a king then?" Pilate said, Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. In fact, the reason I was born and came into the world is to testify to the truth." Here we have the word again. It is to testify to the truth. Everyone on the side of truth listens to me. Everyone who is on the side of truth listens to me. And then Pilate, listening to Jesus, maybe being baffled, he says, "What is truth? What is truth? What really is the truth? In the midst of all what's going on outside there, what is truth?" And let me ask the question this morning. What is truth to us? Have we found the truth? What is truth? And upon hearing this, he went out again. Pilate went out again to the Jews gathered there and said, "I find no basis for a charge against him. I find no basis for a charge against him. There is nothing I found in this man to suggest that he is guilty of anything." Jesus says, "For this reason I was born and came into the world, to testify to the truth." Maybe at one time we were confused. Maybe at one time we did not know the way. Maybe at one time we did not know what life was all about. But when Jesus came, when Jesus came, hallelujah, and he spoke in John, hallelujah, 10, oh glory to God, he says, "The thief comes not but to steal, kill, and destroy. But I have come that you might have life, and that you might have it more abundantly." At one point, we did not know what life is or life was. But when we got a hold of the truth, hallelujah, when we got a hold of the truth, we understand that this life that we were living, this life we thought was all, this life we thought was the best life ever, hallelujah, turned out to be a ticket to hell. Because we were living aimlessly, we were living with no hope, we were living with no purpose. But when Jesus came, hallelujah, and caught us and captured us, oh glory to God, he broke down the prison doors of sin. He broke down the prison doors of hell. He broke down the prison doors of the enemy of Satan, and he freed us. And he says, "Listen, I have set you free, because now you know the truth. Now you know the truth." And this question of truth continues to be a quest for people in this world. People are on a quest to know the truth. They are on a quest to know where we came from. Why are we here? Who are our true ancestors, our true beginnings? They are on a quest to know the truth. But sometimes the obvious is right there and we miss it. Why? Because really, listen to this, really, the truth is a hard pill to swallow. The truth is a hard pill to swallow. We'll come back to that. But let's talk about truth. Let's talk about truth. Truth, when we go into the definition of truth, we'll realize that truth is the interrelated consistency. Now, I want us to listen to the words that are being used in this definition. It's an interrelated consistency of statements. Consistency of statements. Now, in law enforcement, even in the judicial system, there's a word that is being used that's very important. Very important. It is corroborate. Okay? Corroborate. So that means when you have two people or even three people coming with a version of
the facts. So maybe three persons were involved in a crime, and you have to interrogate them, and there is a technique in questioning people. There is a technique that is very powerful in questioning people. You never question people together in the same room. That's a technique. You question them individually. Why? Because you want to get to the truth. And even though all three of them will say, you know, this is what we are going to tell the police when they question us. This is what we are going to tell the police. You know, maybe as a group, they'll be able to succeed. But the technique is you take them individually and you question them individually. And you question them, and there's a certain line of questioning that you ask. And what happens most of the times is you will begin to realize some kind of inconsistency in the information that is being given. So you question the first one and they give you a version. You question the second one and they give you a version. The third one give you another version. And then you go back and you question them based on what you got from the other. And sooner or later, there'll be a breakdown in the system. They will begin to break down. The truth that they are trying to give will turn out to be, you know, a false. There will be some holes in the statements. But you see, truth is the interrelated consistency of statements and their correspondence with the facts of reality and the facts themselves. It suggests an integration of, listen, character. So it's not just about saying what you saw. It's about your character and adherence to virtue. If you are a person who loves the truth, when you see something, you love the truth. And that is true of neighbors. If there's somebody who is living next to you, and for some reason you don't like the best bone in this person, and something, God forbid, happened to this person, and you know who did it. You know who did it. Some people, because they have ought against the neighbor, some people, because they are in bones with the neighbor, they will not go and tell the truth. But there are people who love the truth regardless of the circumstance, because your character cannot accept falsehood. You love the truth. You love justice. You will seek to speak the truth. It speaks of character. Oh, glory to God. Character. An adherence of virtue. Your virtue, your quality, your values, your belief system. A kind of reliability which includes and goes beyond the literal meaning to include those aspects of personal behavior which seem to be implied by the love of truth. The love of truth. It's because you love truth, you will speak the truth. Oh, glory to God. It's because you love truth, you will speak the truth. Oh, glory be to God. And listen, speaking about God and the aspect and the quality of truth when it comes to God, it is another ontological quality of God. It's an ontological. And when we talk about ontological, I've mentioned that before. It speaks about the nature of God. That's just who He is. There is no other way. That's just what God is made up of. Since it is impossible for God to lie, we know that everything He says about what will happen, it will actually happen. God speaks the truth, and the Bible says God is not a man that He should lie. He speaks the truth. That's just who God is. That's just His nature. God is truth. Hallelujah. If we are to become perfect, we need to be known as individuals who tell the truth like God. We take on the nature of God. It is impossible for God to lie. I leave that right there. I'm not calling people liars. But I want us to understand that speaking the truth is a quality of the nature of God. And if we have God in us, that means that nature of truth is supposed to be alive in us. That nature of truth is supposed to be developing and growing in us. Oh, bless the name of Jesus. John says, if we say we have no sin, we make God a liar and the truth is not in us. If we say we have no sin. In Deuteronomy chapter 32 verse 4, listen to what the Bible says about God. He is the rock. His work is perfect, for all his ways are judgments. All his ways are judgment. A God of truth. Listen to that. A God of truth. And without iniquity, he is just and right. Hallelujah. Just and right is he. Oh, glory to God. Bless the name of Jesus. Psalm 19 verse 9 says this. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The judgments of the Lord are true. Oh, and righteous altogether. Oh, thank God. Thank God. Truth. Not only that, but in Psalm 33 verse 4, it says, the word of the Lord is right. Oh, thank you, Jesus. And all his works are done in, look at here, let me underline it, let me highlight it, are done in truth. Bless the name of Jesus. Bless the name of Jesus. So we see here that this ontological quality of God comes out even in scripture. And that's just a few of the scriptures that I have put down that talks about God as truth. Listen to what Psalm 57 verse 10 says. Oh, thank you, Jesus. For thy mercy is great. Thy mercy is great unto the heavens, and thy truth unto the clouds. Oh, bless the name of Jesus. Thy truth unto the clouds. Bless his name. So when we consider this quality and nature of God, it encourages us as believers to say to ourselves, I know it seems difficult to understand. I know the situation around me, the facts that I am seeing around me, it's hard to ignore because it's real. But what God has said that he will do it. In the midst of what's going on, it may look like doom and gloom. It may look like the end. It may look like there is no silver lining. It may look like there is no light at the end of the tunnel. But because God spoke this word, I rely on this word. I depend on this word. I put my trust and my hope on this word. I put my life on the line for this word because God has spoken it. It gives us that kind of assurance that we need to endure, to persevere, because we know God will not give up on us. God will not let us go down the drain. But he will perform what he has spoken. And that's just one aspect of it, because we are focusing on God being truth. The other aspect is God's sovereignty. Because what if he wants to allow us to go down the drain anyhow? That's him. He's God. He has a purpose for allowing us to go down the drain. But we are focusing on his character, his nature, his quality of truth. When God speaks a word and he says, I will do this, be sure that he will do it. Oh, for thy mercy is great unto the heavens, and thy truth unto the clouds. Oh, bless the name of Jesus. When Jesus was addressing his disciples in John chapter 14, he said to them, listen, let not your heart be troubled. Oh, and that's a very good place to be. when we are in a place of peace, when we are in a place of comfort, when we are in a place of assurance, knowing that God is in control, he says to us, let not your heart be troubled. Yes, this world seems like it's going south. Yes, the situation in St. Lucia seems like it's getting worse. Let not your heart be troubled. He says, you believe in God? Believe also in me. Believe in me. There is God in heaven. Yes, there is God the Father. But here I am. I am with you. Believe also in me. And the question is, why should I believe you when we already believe God? Jesus is saying, listen, believe me. Believe me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. And he says, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself. And that where I am, there you may be also. And where I go, you know, and the way you know. A direct promise to the disciples. A direct promise. Listen, I am going and prepare a place, and I will come again and receive you and bring you to that place. A direct promise. And Jesus is saying, believe in me. You believe in God the Father? And of course, that was fundamental. God and the idea of God was fundamental for the Jews. For they had the experience, and they had the testimony, and they had the account and the history of their ancestors, the people of Israelites coming from Egypt, and understanding that God was with them in a pillar of cloud and a pillar of fire. God provided manna. God provided water from the rock. And they knew who God was. And here is this man saying, listen, you believe God, believe also in me, because I am the Son of God. Of course, we know the Jews had issues with that, and we're coming back to the scripture. The Jews had problems with that. How can you put yourself and make yourself equal with God? But he says this, listen, I am going to prepare a place, and I will come back. And he says to them, Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. And Jesus makes this most fundamental and crucial statement to Thomas that has become part of our doctrine as believers, our statement of belief. He says, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way. I am the truth. Now Jesus could have stopped on saying, I am the way. He could have stopped there. He says, you don't know the way. I am the way. But listen to what he says to Thomas. He says, I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. Jesus, by making this statement, substantiates everything he had said before. He substantiates everything he said before. He says, listen, I am going to prepare a place. Now, whether or not the disciples believed him, we don't know. But he makes this statement. He makes this statement. And Thomas said, but listen, well, we don't know where you're going. How can we know the way? He says, listen, I am not only the way. I am the truth. You can rely. You can depend. Depend on what I am telling you, because I am the embodiment of truth. It is my nature, my quality. I am the truth. Oh, glory to God. And I am the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Oh, bless the name of Jesus. Bless the name of Jesus. Oh, thank you, Lord. So we go back to the scripture. And we see that those Jews who believed in Jesus, they were in for something good. They were in for something great. They were in for a marvelous ride. Hallelujah. Just because they believed in Jesus. Because there were some people out there that were warped in their mind. These Jews, they were warped in their mind. And the reason why there were so many clashes between Jesus and the Jews is because Jesus was a vast contrast to the way they were living and what they were doing and their mentality and their philosophy and their theology. Jesus came and he was a difference.
And they could not accept the truth.
And that's another point I want to bring out this morning.
You know, there was a movie, I can't remember the name, but one of those mafia movies. And I think Robert De Niro was in that movie. And one of them said to the effect,
"Tell me the truth."
The other one said,
"You can't handle the truth."
I let me tell you that statement is true today of a lot of us, a lot of people.
A lot of people choose to be in denial when the truth comes. I'm this and I have this problem and I have that problem. You know, I've been experiencing this at work and this at home and they go to a counselor and the counselor begins to unfold their life and eventually it gets to behavior and then it gets to attitude and sooner or later the counselee begins to realize, listen, I have an attitude problem. But you know, instead of admitting they have an attitude problem, they will find somebody to blame. They will pass the buck. Oh, it's my husband. But if my husband was putting his shoes there, if my husband was folding his pants, if my husband or if my wife was doing this, or if the children do this, or if my coworker, if only my coworker. But you have an attitude problem. You came to the counselor to find out what the problem is. Here's the truth. But some people can't handle the truth. Oh my God. He says to them, listen, you are my disciples indeed. If my word abide, if you abide in my word, you are my disciples. And you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. They answered him. Now, if you look at the narrative very well, there are Jews that believed in him. They believed his word, but there were other Jews there as well. So when he said, "You shall know the truth and the truth shall make you free," there were others there who took umbrage, who took offense at what he says. And they answered him and said, "We are Abraham's descendants and we have never been in bondage to anyone."
Oh God,
how can you say you will be made free? We were never in bondage. We are Abraham's children. We have privilege. We have pedigree. We were born with a golden spoon. We were born righteous. In other words, we were born righteous. There is no sin in us. We have not done anything wrong. We are Abraham's children. And that's the mentality of the world today. That's the mentality of the world today. I don't go to fetes. I don't go to parties. I don't steal people's things. I'm not jealous. I'm a good person. You hear people say that. I'm a good person. And they said, listen, we are Abraham's children. We have never been in bondage to anyone. So how can you say that you will be made free? And you know what Jesus answered them? Look at the answer Jesus gave. Jesus answered them, "Most assuredly, I say to you, whoever commits sin is a slave of sin." But where did sin come from? Where did that come from in the conversation? Where did that come from? They were talking about the truth and Abraham. You know, where did that come from? But you see, the thing is, Jesus is always able to see past the surface and look into the heart of the matter. And the thing is, a lot of people right now, we are in denial. We live in denial. We know the truth, But instead of facing the truth, we rather go into denial and saying, you know, it's not my fault. I have been wronged, and this is how I was born. This is who I am. I inherited this from my father. Denial. Instead of standing up to the truth, I have a problem. I have a problem.
As I was preparing this meditation, the title that came to mind was Real People Get Real Help. Real People Get Real Help. You know, and maybe it would be a true reflection of what Jesus is saying. Listen, it's time for you to be real here. Yeah, you say you are children of Abraham, you have never been in bondage, but the truth is you are in bondage right now. Oh, because that's the reason why I came. It's because all of us have sinned and we have fallen short of the glory of God. So I have come that you may have life and have it more abundantly. I have come that you may know the truth. I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life, that you may know me and be made free. So even though they were trying to put on a facade, they were trying to put on something, you know, a mask, Jesus was able to go beneath this and said to them, listen, anyone who commits sin is a slave to sin. And that's the reality. That's the truth. As Paul says, whoever we give our lives to serve, to that person we become a slave. Whether it be to sin that leads to death, we serve sin, our attitude, our behavior, our flesh, we gratify the flesh. We find ourselves every day, we need to satisfy that flesh because we have availed ourselves to the flesh, to serve the flesh as a slave. But Paul says the same is true about the Spirit. If we give ourselves to the Spirit and we serve the Spirit, we become a slave to righteousness. We become a slave to doing what is right. That's the truth. And sometimes we have to accept the truth. Because we know the truth. We have to accept the truth. The Jews didn't want to accept the truth. Who are you to tell us that you will make us free? We have never been in bondage. You have never been in captivity to anybody. We are no man's slave. No, not a man, but sin, yes. Everyone who commits sin, he says, is a slave to sin, a slave of sin. And a slave does not abide in a house forever, but a son abides forever. Yeah, because you see, in the house, you have the master, you have the servant, and sometimes you have a son. And servants can come and go, but the son is always in the house. And he says, listen, therefore, if the Son makes you free, you shall be free indeed. If the Son, therefore, shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. Do you want to be free today? You know, I encourage, you know, us all, when we go to seek counsel, when we go for help. Yes, we can go for counsel. We can go for help. Counselors, God has placed wonderful counselors on this earth. Wonderful counselors in the church. When we feel that we need some extra help and we go to counselors, be prepared to accept the truth. Because counselors have been trained to lead people to self-discovery. And when we begin to discover who we are, we have to be prepared to accept the truth. And as believers, when we get to know the truth about ourselves, what it should do is to point us to the truth about God. And when we get to know the truth about God, it is that truth now that will make us free. It is that truth that will now begin to open prison doors in our lives. Oh, glory to God. God will use a human being maybe to help us discover these places in our lives through good training,
discover these places, and I endorse counselors. I endorse that profession because it's needful. It is needful, especially in the church. Yes, we can say, well, the Spirit will do this, the Spirit will do that, but God has placed teachers, He has placed pastors, He has placed evangelists for different reasons. And in the church, we have counselors, people who have gone through a professional training, especially Christian counselors, that when they begin to lead us to self-discovery, when we begin to go into ourselves and realize some of the areas in our lives where we really fall short, it is supposed to point us, as believers, point us to the truth of God. And Jesus says, listen, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. What is he saying? The more you know of me, the more you get to know me, the more of me you have in you, hallelujah, the more freedom you'll be able to walk in. This morning, I trust that we'll be able to walk in that freedom that God is giving us through the truth. Oh, glory to God. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you. We praise you. We bless you for your word. We bless you for your son. Thank you for the work on Calvary that you accomplished, oh God, so mightily. Oh God, may we, as your children, your people, continue to walk in truth. Continue to abide in truth, oh God. Because indeed you are truth. There is no lie in you. You are consistent. You are true to your word. You will do what you have promised unto dear God. We thank you and we praise you. Because, oh Father, hallelujah, we know that what you have spoken, you will perform. Hallelujah. And we give you praise. We give you thanks. We give you glory in the mighty name of Jesus. In the mighty name of our wonderful Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. I trust that you were blessed this morning. I trust that, hallelujah, you were able to glean something from the word this morning by the grace of God, and that you were able to, hallelujah, be strengthened and encouraged today in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. And if I'm just scanning the chats to see if I've missed any prayer requests. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Bless the name of Jesus. Bless the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Bless the name of Jesus. Oh, glory to God. I trust that we'll be able to walk in this victory today because of the truth of God that is, hallelujah, in us. Bless the name of Jesus. Don't forget, today we are praying. This is the 10th day of our fasting. We are praying for those who are lost. We are praying for the unsaved. You know, I'm praying that God would give us an unquenchable passion for the lost. You know, an unquenchable passion for us to share the message of the Lord Jesus Christ with those who are dying without Jesus Christ. I pray that God would stir up in our spirit, hallelujah, that zeal for those people out there who are dying without the Lord Jesus Christ. And indeed, God himself, hallelujah, will give us the strategies. God himself will give us what we need for us to bring that message of truth, bring that message of hope, bring that message of love to those people who are out there dying without Christ. Hallelujah. Well, if you're celebrating a birthday today, we just thank God and we praise God for you. And we pray that God will continue to bless you. Today we are celebrating the birthday of Sister Donna Obeyus. Sister Donna Obeyus. Hallelujah. Today is Vidra Henry's birthday. Vidra Henry. Hallelujah. God bless you. And Leandra Sonny,
God bless you today celebrating birthdays. May God bless you. May God cause his face to shine upon you. May God enlarge you and cause your boundaries to fall on pleasant places in the mighty name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Today is a day of victory for you in the name of Jesus. If you're celebrating a wedding anniversary today, may God bless your marriage union. May God cause his favor to rain upon you in the mighty name of Jesus. Oh, glory to God. And we thank God and we praise God for all of you today in Jesus' mighty and precious name. Hallelujah. Well, we have come to the end of the session today. Hallelujah. Yes, Sister Vicky, your Vidra is celebrating her birthday today. Glory to God. Hallelujah. We have come to the end of the session today. Trust that you're going to have a wonderful, powerful, victorious day today. Hallelujah. Walking in the truth of God. Walking in the knowledge of the truth. Hallelujah. That we have been set free by the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. May you walk securely today. Not forgetting, observe the protocols. Protect yourself. Protect your family. Wear your mask, wear your sanitize your hands, and do the things that are necessary to get by this season of your life in the name of Jesus. Well, we love you. God loves you. We thank you. Hallelujah for joining again. And until tomorrow, God willing, on morning meditation, you have a blessed day today. Again, today's Tuesday, and today is supposed to be Bible study. And trust that all will go well today so we can go through the material. And of course, God will give us the grace to do so. Okay, God bless you. We love you. Take care as we leave. I will leave you with this song I played yesterday and didn't play the whole one, but here again, I just love this song. I just love this song. Trust that it will be a blessing to you as well. God bless you. Take care.
Can't go back to the beginning. Can't control what tomorrow will bring. But I know here in the middle is the place where you promised to be. Shaping the shadow.